And so I started digging deeper, and I discovered that in every culture, for example, in the Greek culture, there's a similar concept. It's called metanoia, the coming together, a change of heart, a change of mind. In Zen Buddhism, it's called satori, enlightenment. And virtually every ancient culture has a word for this type of experience. So it is not a new experience. It's one that humankind has been experiencing for a long, long time, particularly in its, among its wise men, its philosophers and thinkers. And in my own opinion, and looking at through all the depth of this over the years, I realized that type of experience is the basis of the cultural religion that arose in virtually every part of our civilization. That's to call it a mountaintop experience, a peak experience, a big picture effect of seeing things in a larger picture, and all of a sudden you're this overwhelmed with the immensity and the beauty of it, along with a sense of ecstasy and joy. And the real question here for the study of consciousness, it looks like this is built right into the very physics of the way the universe is put together, because people have been having this type of experience since ancient times. But some of us that went to the moon, in fact, all of us that went to the moon and looked back at Earth, had some variety of this type of experience. And a book's been written about it called The Overview Effect by Frank White. And because he researched, because we've all talked somewhat, now we have a different view on it, a different take, a different explanation.
Going back to the Institute of Noetic Sciences, Considering your experience and considering the fact that the Institute of Noetic Sciences really focuses on consciousness and psychic events, there's two things I want to ask you about. The first thing is do you believe and have you studied that your experience is in any way related to pineal gland activity? Is it anything that you think would be physiological as opposed to mystic?
There's a lot of work going on to study just exactly how the brain and the organs of the brain body enter into all of this. Yes, certainly there are physiological effects here. And in recent times, the work has resulted in a great deal of study of the brain and neurology and so forth. There are some, of course, that say consciousness is only about the brain, and I would disagree with that completely, that it's a larger subject than just the physiology of the brain body. For example, one of the basic definitions here from quantum mechanics is that we understand that particles at the subatomic level that are engaged in interaction or in a interactive process and go apart from each other, they maintain quantum correlation. Now, the literature says, quote, unquote, particles know they've interacted and maintain correlation with the other as a result of that interaction process. Well, knowing is really about awareness. Awareness is the basis of consciousness. So we can say that quantum correlation at the subatomic level looks like it demonstrates a very fundamental aspect of what we call consciousness. In other words, the interaction and correlation, quantum correlation of subatomic matter.
Now, there's a whole nother subject that I want to ask you about that is connected to some degree by subject. You were remote healed by somebody that lives in Vancouver when you had kidney cancer. Can you explain that to me?
Well, I've had two different sessions on this. Certainly, healing is fundamental to the consciousness that we're talking about. If you want to go back into any of the religious traditions, even particularly Christianity, Jesus was a healer. And so this act of healing is very fundamental. It's a psychic phenomenon, if you want to call it that, that has been dismissed and discarded by science for most of the 400 years that science has been unwilling to take a look at consciousness. But the fact is my own personal experience and experience, much of the research that I have done has been in the realm of science, of healing, and I have personally had a healing experience of prostate cancer and kidney cancer that has been healed by alternative means. And I have studied quite a number of other cases. I'm quite familiar with it. Can I totally explain how this happens? No, I cannot. But that is a part of the research, is to help us understand this mechanism of health and healing, using the interaction of mind and consciousness in ways that science has yet to fully explain.
So what's the next step? Where do we go from here? What is your hope
to,
that...
To continue the research, and I consider that's a part of the of frontier science, of understanding, for example, I'll use a phrase, I do not know how to write an equation for intention or intentionality, but it's pretty fundamental to the way mind and matter interact. There has to be intention for mind-matter interaction, but how do I, I'm joking here a bit, how do you write an equation for intentionality? Nobody knows the answer to that yet.
NASA discontinued the shuttle program. What are your thoughts about the state of where NASA is right now?
I don't like the state that NASA's in right now, but let me point out a couple of things. First of all, at the beginning of the 20th century, the Wright brothers invented aircraft, but by the 1920s, we already had airline industry. So within 20 years, the discovery of aviation turned into a enterprise. And that is what the current government has essentially done, is to say, let's move into free enterprise, let's move into the corporate world, and pass the ball to them to carry on, instead of government continuing to do all of the flight research. Well, I don't like to see that happen quite this way. However, our president and our current government is trying to recover from a very strong event. Our economy is in very, very deep trouble, has been for the last 3 or 4 years. And the main thing here is to get the economy going again. And space is there for us to pursue, and we will pursue it. In due course, we will go on to Mars. We will go on to the asteroid belt. We will continue space exploration, just in a different mode than we're in right now.
What do you think about those who say we've already been to Mars? To give you an example, there's the gentleman named Henry Deacon who claims to have already been on Mars, worked for us for years, and been there on multiple times. Do you think those kind of programs really exist?
Well, most of what you hear along those lines is total BS. There's not any truth in it at all that I'm aware of. If, however, to the extent that there is some truth in it, it would have to involve the presence of ETs. It would have to involve those presence, because we do not have on this planet the capability of manned exploration of Mars at this point in time. The propulsion system, the guidance systems, everything that we have in the space program are not adequate for that task.
The founder of Skunk Works, the CEO of Skunk Works before it ended, Ben Rich, said his deathbed confessional that we had the ability to take ET home and back. What are your thoughts on that?
What he said, if that is true, and I think there's a possibility that that is true, that really means that the whole exploration of visitation by ETs has resulted in our being able to interact with that type of propulsion systems and that type of technology, and in some measure we've learned to use it. And so if what Rich is saying is true, I would suspect that's